Well, praise God. Here we are assembled again, waiting on our mighty God to transform us with hope and expectation. I hope and pray that you've come to be touched by Him, because that's what His house has always been for. That's why He makes holy ground for us to be able to come to. Well, there's many issues of life that we don't stand on holy ground, that we are trying to live life, but God says, raises His little flag on His mountain and says, hey, you want to come stand on some holy ground and chat for a while? And of course, if God's got a little chat that He wants to do, it's life-changing and it's life-giving and it's full of joy. The experience with Him is always just overwhelming in our hearts and in our minds, and it changes the ground that we go out on. The ground that we came from is always infected the ground we go to, since we have touched that which is holy. If we become holy, then the ground we go stand on becomes holy. That's a good way to keep the ground sanctified where we live, where we work, where we play. God is all about us living and playing with Him on His playground. As a matter of fact, whenever I lose that concept of being His little child, I get kind of stuffy. And I don't like being stuffy. I don't like being religious, because when you get religious, then God's kind of, He's in the background. But when you get real, that only happens when He's real. And so He's waiting on us to get real, and He's ready to get real. He's ready to come and speak to us and lead us and guide us and breathe upon us and refresh us and come. He's ready to come and bring some healing, which, by the way, let's pray for Elton. He is that direction. Father, we just bring our brother to You. We ask You for Your mighty intervention today in his tummy and all that region and all the things that are going on. We ask You to heal our brother. With Your great healing power, go forth and touch him in Jesus' great and powerful name. Amen, amen, amen. Well, how about we ask the Lord to come and be in our midst and talk to us? And do you need a bath or a shower, or did you take one before you came here? We need Him to turn on the fire hose and wash us down, right? Lord, we humbly come before You. We ask You to come and hover over us with Your power, with Your presence, with Your mind, with Your heart, with Your spirit, with Your cleansing, with Your rejoicing, with Your forgiveness, with Your hope for our future, Lord. And most, Lord, with Your presence. We cry out for Your presence. We cry out for You, Lord. Now come into our midst. And Holy Spirit, come and manifest Yourself and Him to us, that we might worship our great King. In Jesus' great name I pray. Amen. Somebody's Harley blew up.
Just one, two.
How about y'all just stand up so we can get this
show on the road. As we worship and magnify the Lord today, declare His goodness to us. Oh, aren't you glad you're His? Oh, I tell you what, if I wasn't His this week, oh my goodness, I don't know that I would have made it. And since I've had very little sleep this week, I'm going to really rely upon y'all to help me worship Him. So.
Water, Lord, I'll die, Lord, I'll die. rushing water, Jesus, life healing flow. I need living water, or I'll die, Lord, and go. You are living water, pure, refreshing water. You are living water for my soul.
You are living water. Living water, for I'll die, Lord, I know. You are living water, your pure, refreshing water. You are living water for my soul. You are living water for my soul. You are living water.
Living water. I am the light that leads you. I am the truth that teaches you right from wrong. And I want you to know that I am love. So many of you long to be loved. So many of you seek to be loved. All my children are bereft of love unless they have received my love. There is no love separate from me. There is only lust, or longing, or emptiness. Only true love can be found in my presence. If you know that you are lacking love, then come and ask. Ask me to fill you with my love so that you can love others purely, without condition, with my love. First, though, you have to receive my love. You have to know that it's permanent and it's without condition. You cannot separate yourself off from my love. You can disobey me and you can wander off, but you cannot separate yourself off from my love. Ask to be filled with my love so that you have that love with which to love yourself and your brother.
For all that you have done.
Done for me, I will.
Belongs to you. never be dismayed by numbers. You've seen some come and you've seen some go. But know this, it is the heart that I look upon. It is the heart that is obedient to me. I tell you, I can do more with this. And my presence can come and my head can be placed on a heart of obedience. As you come together, it is your heart and your obedience that I am after. It is you, every one of you, my children, that has a heart of obedience for me. I can do much more with this. No matter the number, I'm the one who puts this together.
Taken away all your trespasses, my love.
Thank you, Jesus.
I have cleansed you. Won't you receive my righteousness? I stand before my Father and justify you. And I am proud to do so. I have accomplished such great work on your behalf. It is my joy to do so. I sit at the right hand of my Father, your Father. And we are pleased, so pleased for your great treasure to us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Receive what I have for you.
Yes.
And be my son of good faith and my daughter of good faith. I can handle your sin. I ask you to handle your heart and keep it in me and for me. It will be the joy of your life. Come and receive my mercy. I have it to pour out upon you. My grace is abundant. My heart swells toward you. I can be found this hour.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Oh, thank you. Oh, Lord, you've always been so good, so merciful, even in your holiness. Your rightness, Lord. You don't cause that to keep us from coming to you. Oh, Lord, you justify us. Oh, you justify us. Your holiness. Oh, Lord, you make us holy. Redeeming us so, Lord, that you wouldn't just cast us aside and give up on us, Lord, but you give us moments like this in your presence to come and dance in your chambers.
Holy, holy is he. flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing in all her strength, glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Gentlemen, if you will come for our, as we continue to worship our Lord with our tithes and with our offerings, if you would come forward, we'd like to lay hands upon us. You'll extend your hands. Lord, we humbly come before you. And that which belongs to you, we joyfully, joyfully give to you. And that which you've given us, we give up to you with absolute serenity, knowing that you're our great supplier. So I ask you, Lord, would you bless Would you lay your hands and bless and multiply that which is given? And would you also, Lord, bless the giver and use this for your work, for your kingdom, for your name's sake, for your glory? In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. You may go forth. Do we have any announcements?
As y'all know, we have the Proverbs coming up in April, starting up again. That'll be the second Saturday in April. I think it's the 12th. And so we'll be having our steering committee meeting this Tuesday night to discuss that and what all the plans are for pulling that together. So if you're able to attend that meeting, that would be wonderful. Even if you're not on the steering committee, we would really love your input, and so you kind of see where the direction of the meeting is going, and can be in prayer about that meeting as well. Denise is going to be our main speaker that day, so I know she'll really covet your prayers, and Nancy will be doing one of the workshops for the ladies, and so y'all could be keeping her in your prayers too. That'd be great. Wednesday we're going to start setting up some of the decorations, since Curtis and I and our family are going to be gone on vacation the following week, so I won't be here to help with that. But of course, Gail might be around to do things. I don't know. I'll just leave that. Get in touch with her that week. She's in charge. And but we do need some extra hands. So if you're available on Wednesday and would like to come up and help us put a contraption together, that would be good, because we have a big contraption to put together for a part of our decorations, and then getting them out and all that jazz. So could certainly use your help with all of that. So we have prayer tonight at 5:00, and hope you can make it. It's amazing how many of you do come, and it's such an awesome and powerful time. So I hope you'll make that for there.
Things. There we go. Pilot error. It's not the first time I've crashed. I remember when I first started flying back when I was young. I went to pilot school, started when I was 16. And I remember asking my, you know, after going through the ground school and starting my flight training and all that stuff, and up doing lazy eights, and, you know, in a small plane, it's basically, and you look like you're going 2 miles an hour. I mean, a tricycle could pass you with a four-year-old on it. That's how slow you look you're going, you know. And in the midst of that, I remember asking my instructor. And we had become, he was probably, I'm going to say 30, something like that. And here I am, 16. And we'd become familiar with each other. And after practicing for maybe an hour of those things, dull, boring as can be, I mean, boring. And I said, won't this crate do anything but fly straight and level? And he said, well, kid, let's see if you got any hair on your upper lip. And he said, I want you to pull back on the wheel and just keep pulling and keep pulling. And, you know, okay, I'm pulling back and pulling back and pulling back. All of a sudden I hear this. He says, okay, it's ready. I want you to put in a little left rudder. I'm thinking, well, left rudder, that means we're going to turn. It was a turn, all right. It was a turn and a half. That plane flipped over upside down and just started. Yeah.
what do I do? What do I do? You know, and I wasn't asking what I did. He just, I could hear him just laughing. In my mind's eye, we're tearing the wings off the plane. All I see is the earth, and it's that away, and it's spinning around and around. It's spinning. I'm not. We're standing still. The world is spinning. How do you stop the world? And, of course, he pulls it out of the stall and out of the spin. And, you know, and I'm over there. Our spiritual experiences are much like that in our Lord. There's some things that we have to learn along the way. They're quite mundane. Quite mundane, quite boring. We think we know it all, and so we don't listen. We're occupied on our cell phones, or occupied in our own books, or occupied with our own thoughts, or our own purposes. And we need a little nudge from the Lord to pay attention, because there in the mundane things is where we get the feel of what it is like to fly right, because there's going to be stormy weather when you can't fly right. There's going to be some things happen. I've gotten some downdrafts before. I was in a helicopter one time, flying a helicopter out in the Gulf of Mexico. And we were flying. In the Gulf of Mexico, you get these huge towering, because it's that humid air that causes all the tornadoes and thunderstorms and all that stuff all the way up into the Great Lakes area. I mean, you can just follow the line of it. It starts in March. In south of Texas, and it marches forward all the way to the north. What it is, it's a clash of the cold air and the humid Gulf air meeting. Well, I'm over humid Gulf air. And out there in the midst of that are these towering columns shooting up sometime to 50,000 feet. And you don't want to fly through those, you fly around those. And kind of weave in and out and get up close to where you can get in between the gaps and all that stuff. But unbeknownst to me, one of those was coming up from below. And it kind of engulfed me. And boy, talk about topsy-turvy. And I wasn't real used to flying a helicopter and didn't have a license to fly one. The pilot just said, here, you know how to fly this thing, you know. Yeah, you know, it's a totally new experience, and I had done that quite a few times and stuff like that and getting the hang of it, but wasn't prepared for that, and neither was he. And needless to say, it was a scary, scary thing. There's some scary things that are going to happen in your life. And having the history of what it feels like, what the plane feels like, is a notable thing for us to have within our grasp. We have been doing some mundane things, flying along and teaching you and administering God's grace to you and trying to bring you into some form of doing lazy eights right. Because I remember doing lazy eights and thinking, wow, I did that perfect. And the guy said, you lost 100 feet in elevation in that eight. Let's go back and try it again. Oh, you gained 50 feet in elevation. Let's go back and try it again. Because, see, you had to end up at the same elevation. And you had to do it in such a width and such an expanse and such a length and such time and end up at the same elevation. So that your turns, you're not losing elevation in your turns. You stay at that same altitude. It's important to be able to stay at the same altitude through all those turns. And there's a problem. We don't stay at the same altitude when we come into different turns of our life. We're turning and we think we're doing all right, but we're, you know. If you're in bad weather, you can end up in the ground. If there's mountains around you and you don't know it, you can end up in the ground. There's in Texas on the hill there in Grand Prairie, above Grand Prairie. It's called Cedar Hill area. It's called Cedar Hill. It's a hill. Comes up about 2,000 feet, and there's a 2,600-foot radio tower on that thing. 2,600 feet. It's got lights on it. A couple of times, planes have clipped that thing. Planes have clipped that thing. I mean, there's a wide open sky with nothing in it and one little tower sticking up in the middle of the whole countryside there. And how can that find its way and where you clip it? Now, fortunately, those planes didn't crash. They just barely clipped it and maybe lost some of the running gear and stuff like that. And it's been fixed several times. There are things in life sticking up that you will run into. So our colloquial training down at the bottom of the hill of God, if you want to call it that, I'm assuming that you want to become his disciple. Disciple is a disciplined learner. Somebody's got to be doing the disciplining, and I'm one of his discipliners. And it is not a pleasant thing to try to teach somebody even a simple thing of saying yes, sir, and no, sir. I mean, that's the first thing they teach you in military when you go to boot camp is, and they don't ask you, they tell you, this is your speech to me, son. Everything I say to you, one, you acknowledge what I say by saying, sir. And then you acknowledge that you understand it by saying, yes, sir. So everything a drill sergeant is supposed to hear is, sir, yes, sir, sir, yes, sir, sir, yes, sir, until it is drilled in that recruit's head so that it becomes a part of his lifestyle to say, sir, yes, sir. Now, why? It seems like a stupid, silly term. It seems mundane. It seems like, okay, you want to be a demagogue. You want to be worshipped. You want to be something that is great. No, there's someday there's going to be bullets flying over that recruit's head and hand grenades passing by, and that drill sergeant is going to be there with them. That's the way it was in World War II. The drill sergeant that trained him was the one that went into battle with them. And bullets are flying over their heads. And he has to be able to give the command, hit the dirt! What do you mean by that? You're going to hit the dirt one way or the other. So God's teaching to us and trying to get us in obedience is preparing us for this cataclysmic battle. Because we have entered the kingdom of God, and there's a kingdom of darkness we've been rescued from, but there's a kingdom of darkness that's still at war against us. It is at war. Jesus is at war with every demonic force. He never met a demonic force he liked, and he certainly didn't like the boss. And he directly confronted them. He directly stepped on their toes. He directly went into the world where the kingdom of darkness was and brought the kingdom of righteousness and the kingdom of light. And so he is training us. Since he knows it's going to be a battle while we're in training and in boot camp, we're not in that battle. We're in training. But we get so bored with our training. So God's calling us higher. Higher means from where we are to some place we have not been, or some place it's been a long time since we've been. Because I've met many people that climb the mountain, but they're not living there. He's calling us to come from our lower places. And that lower place doesn't have to be the place of sin. The lower place can be that Cessna 150 that I was flying. It had a certain ceiling. It was not supposed to go over 15,000 feet. It was not equipped with oxygen. The engine was not equipped to handle the lack of oxygen. But there were other planes that you could get into that did have that equipment, and they could take you to 20,000 feet. It's much smoother flying at 20,000 feet than it is 15. A lot more turbulent down at 10, a lot more turbulent down at 6. at 6,000 feet, when you're flying over different fields, if you fly over a brown field, you're flying along, and then you fly over this beautiful green field, and all of a sudden something hits you that feels like it tears your wings off, and you shoot about 400 feet in the air. There's thermals coming off of those green fields. You're not expecting those. I remember the first time I was riding thermals, I was about 12 years old, maybe 8 years old. I don't remember. No, 10. I had gone to see my Uncle C.B. He lived in Borger, Texas. He was a pilot during World War II, flew the bombers over Germany and made it back alive. And he took me up in his plane, and I didn't buckle up. I was in the back, and we were flying along. Hit a thermal, boom! I mean, we shot up maybe 500 feet in the air, and we're just, you're just glued. And then all of a sudden, we dropped out of the thermal. Now, it was okay catching the rise without the seatbelt. When the elevator went the other way, I was just stuck on the ceiling with my neck and head crushed against the ceiling until the plane leveled out. Put a dent in my head, scared me about flying. I was afraid to fly, but I loved flying. I was afraid of it. But why was I afraid of it? I didn't have my seatbelt on. And there was something that's unexpected that happened. So God, our Lord Jesus, is calling us higher and higher and higher into His presence. But there has to be a reason behind that. It's just not so we can climb higher and just so we can learn more. Jesus didn't come. He learned obedience to His Father. And everything He did, it was out of obedience. But He came for a purpose, did He not? He came to accomplish something for God. And there's the thing, God's calling us to know Him into those higher places and calling us into newness. You know what newness is in Scripture when it talks about that He's going to renew us, He's going to make us new? Newness means the manifest presence. He wants to bring us into a manifest. But you know what a manifest presence is? If Jesus appears in our midst, that's manifest. And if He stays with us and hangs with us while we worship and while we praise Him, what would our reaction be if we could physically experience His form? A little bit different reaction than what we're currently having in our mundaneness. So He's called us into a manifest presence into our mind. The mind must have an understanding of when Jesus comes and how to maintain and stay in His presence and keep that altitude through the turns of life. The heart must have an absolute, unabiding trust that it can keep the altitude as it flies. And it can't do that unless the manifest presence of Jesus is sitting next to you. Sure, this is no problem. He says, I want you to do a roll for me. Well, sure, Lord. But don't lose any altitude. Yes, Lord. See, losing altitude, our faith kind of falters. See, that's what losing altitude is. I want you to just roll out to the same altitude. Yes, my Lord. Now, you're going to be concentrating on keeping control of the ship. But your heart has to be assured, He's sitting right here. He can grab the controls at any time. And He's going to help me through this. But He wants to help us through it until we can master it, because He wants us to be able to have that capability. He wants us to not falter in our faith through the twists and turns and upside down things of life. And there's life. There is no life unless it's in the Holy Spirit. We are dead unless we're in the Holy Spirit. Jesus came to give life because we had no life. And so we can't call our existence here on earth life. We can only call our existence in the revelational manifest presence of Jesus, there's life. Without that, we're back in our death of our dead lives. What's our objective? Y'all recognize these are some of our church members. They're in the high hills. They're in the foothills. They're climbing. They're going for God. We do need to play in the foothills. I remember as a kid living in Victorville, California, and there was a bunch of hills around there that were on the other side of the Mojave River, so we would have to go down and wade across the Mojave River, and which comes down out of the mountains there, the Sierra Nevadas. Beautiful water, crystal clear water. We'd wade across there and get over to the area at the bottom of those foothills, and these huge boulders. I mean, a small boulder would be as tall as a ceiling. And there's millions of them. And they're stacked on top of each other. And some of them are 5-10 stories tall. They're like big buildings. And since they're all laying over each other, there's all these passageways and caves and things amongst them. And you could get against the rocks and push and climb up and get on top of those things. And then we learned how to jump from rock to rock to rock. My mother wasn't there. She'd had a heart attack. But we were, woo-hoo! And we were cautious. We were cautious. We started out with the little rocks. Those only one story tall, so you couldn't fall too far. And we were paired up, so we knew if one of us got hurt, there's somebody there that can help. Always have to have somebody to help. And part of the problem in our training is if we get off on our own, there's no one to train us. You can't say you're being trained. It is, if you notice, these two friends of ours, our church members here in this photo, are climbing, are exploring some of the higher things in God. But there comes a time when our understanding needs to rise because He's calling us. He's calling us. Does Christ have an objective for you in this life? And does He define it in Scripture? What's His objective? Why are we supposed to learn all these things? Can He enable us to achieve the objective that He wants us to do? Question, is it beyond our capacity? Is it beyond our capability of what He's calling? Because the things He has to call us to is directly opposed to those things that we want to do. You understand that, right? Flesh doesn't want to do what God wants done. But if we're in the Spirit, then the heart leaps to want to do that which God wants done. The Spirit person within you is a different person than the flesh person that just wants life at ease and life its way. John 14:10-18. Jesus shows up. This is after His resurrection. No, excuse me. That's going to be another passage. Jesus makes this statement. Truly I say to you, he who believes in me. I'm going to back up here. Remember we were talking about objectives. What's His objective? Here's His objective, John 14:10. Truly I say to you, he who believes in me, do you believe in him? Do you know you can measure that? And we're supposed to measure that whether we believe in him or not? He who believes in me, the works I do, he will also do. So if you're a believer, the works that Jesus does, you're supposed to be doing those, right? Are you in agreement with me? He will do also greater works than these he will do because I go to the Father. So I would like you to understand that if we're not involved in the works of Jesus, there's something to be pointed at as to whether we're a believer. Is it not right? There's something to be pointed at. Now, we can think, we remember the little mouse ear guys and ladies that were on the hill there, they can think that they're doing the works of Jesus, but they were just exploring. As much exploring that we need to do for experience. But Jesus says this, he says, whatever you ask in my name, that will I do so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Do you have the capability of listening to Jesus and asking Him to do something and Him literally, physically, from the spiritual side, do it in the material side of our reality? There's a marriage of His supernatural into our natural. And He's saying, if you're a believer, my supernatural is supposed to materialize inside the natural reality that you have, making it a supernatural reality of my presence, my mind, my heart, my purposes. That's something that we need to work on, is His supernatural. Is the supernatural is the manifest presence of Jesus, and the manifest presence of Jesus is what began the early church and what caused the early church to explode. If you go in and you read all the instances of the gospel being preached, there's only one incident where the gospel, and it was a halfway gospel, was preached without the miraculous taking place. Do you know what that was? It's when Apollos was in Corinth. He came and he preached that Jesus was the Messiah. The believers there received that Jesus was the Messiah, and they were baptized into repentance. That's what me as a good Baptist, I was baptized. Yes, Lord, I repent. I'm baptized for my sins, so forth and so on. But Paul shows up and he says, found a group of disciples and says, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? And we hadn't even heard of such. And so they go through the process again, this time with experiential revelation of the supernatural taking place, because they all prophesied, they all were given their languages from heaven of the angels. There was a miraculous thing that took place to substantiate their experience with God. That now it was an experience, it wasn't learned knowledge. Learned knowledge was when I was sitting in ground school and I went through weeks and weeks and weeks of studying all kinds of things, from weather, clouds, to how to make your way across the United States, how to use the computer. It used to be circular. Did you know that a computer used to be circular? And you moved it with your thumbs? That was the way you plotted yourself on your maps. There was actually a computer before they came out with the tin can one. Now, if Jesus is making a statement that we're supposed to do greater works than He has done when He was on earth, He did some pretty magnificent works here on earth, right? I got this little picture in my mind, a little cartoon picture, of somebody coming up and seeing this beautiful canyon that is, you know, 5,000 feet deep. I don't know if you've ever been to Grand Canyon. This is not the Grand Canyon, but Grand Canyon, you can look down over a mile. And you see this huge hole in the ground. And you're like, wow! And a little sign stuck up over here with a mountain drawn in it, and a circle around it, and a big red line across it. And then underneath, there's no moving mountains. Do you get that? You don't get that? Scripture says if you have the faith that's in a mustard seed, you can speak to a mountain and command it to be cast into the sea. Now, if we really got on the bandwagon with our Lord Jesus and came into faith and came into believing, instead of just practicing and playing, imagine the first thing that God would do if I was Him. I would put up some signs in the Grand Tetons. Do not move these mountains. I like them here. Right? I don't think God's a liar when He says that if you have faith, it can move mountains. He did every manner of things and said, I want you to do greater things than I've done. What it will do, it will bring glory to the Father and to me. He tied the manifest presence of the miraculous in with the bringing glory to Him. The preaching of the gospel never was generic. It was never just classroom stuff. It was always something that was experiential. And most of us inside, when God begins to call us to Himself, don't realize. He says, if you ask me anything in my name, I will do it for you. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Now, we've spent a lot of time on the mundane part, keep my commandments. We've tried to spend a lot of time of teaching you how to love Him. But do you see, without keeping His commandments and without loving Him, how can we ever get to the part of asking Him anything in His name and Him doing it? Can you see how the two are tied together? That's been our purpose of being a disciplined learner, is to get to know Him, to climb up into the heights of where He's at. Our objectivity is to go higher. We must, first of all, see the objective that God can be reached. We can make it into His presence, but just because we make it into the presence, was just getting into His presence what He wanted us to accomplish? See, most of us look at that for just the next level of experience, and God is saying, well, yeah, I want you to have that experience, but will you let me train you? I got some things I want done on my planet Earth, and I put you there. And remember, Adam, he had a job. He had things he was supposed to do for my planet Earth. So yes, it's vitally important that we have the individual experiences. But you cannot get to the top of this mountain by yourself, or I should say, you better not try. Because if we're going to go into the manifest presence of God in the highest altitude that there's no oxygen, it's beyond your capabilities and stress on your body. So He's going to have to help us get there. And there are many people who don't respond to Him, because He's calling us. He's calling us. He's saying in Matthew 11:28, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. Are you heavy laden? We are. We have the burden of relational functionalities with those who, they're just not functional with us. When will they ever grow up? Whoever they are, right? We got life itself that we want to accomplish and do certain things. And we want to be free. We want to be free. We're always trying to be free. We're specialists on that here in America. You realize in Jesus' time, most of the society was never free. They could never work to gain freedom. They were slaves. They were bought like cattle and sold like cattle, and they worked like cattle, and they died like cattle. But yet those people were Christians and went to heights with Jesus Christ and weren't looking for their freedom. Matter of fact, Jesus said, if you're a slave, be the best. He didn't say, since you're a slave, go try to talk to your master and get him saved, and maybe he'll let you go free. We don't need a freedom. We need to enlist and become His slave. And if we're His slave, we can be a slave anywhere, for anyone, as long as He's standing there next to us. So He says, come to me, all you who are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. You can't learn from Him unless you're willing to take the yoke. I meet many people with itching ears that want to hear and hear and hear the newest, latest thing. Want to hear prophecies, want to hear words of knowledge and all that stuff. But they never want to take up the yoke. And those people usually get tired and, you know, well, I don't, this is too heavy. I don't want that yoke on me. And they'd throw it off. I've seen that all of my life. I'm talking with John Castile one time, and he saw that all of his life. But there were those who did not want to take the yoke. Disciples want to take the yoke. The yoke of what God wants to do. It becomes primost in our heart to accomplish those things. But He also makes this. He said, you learn from me. And not, instead of learning about Him, which most Christianity is learning about Him, it is sterile. This learning about Him is sterile. You know what sterile is? That something if Jesus was to walk into a hospital and there's a major surgery that's going to happen, all the doctors in there would have that place sterilized, and here comes Jesus in his robe, and he opens the door, and they all panic. Get out of here! You're not sterile! You're not sterile! He's there to heal. He's there to raise up. They say, get out of our environment. We'll take care of this. This is a sterile place. We don't need your healings. We don't need your miracles. We don't need your guidance. We don't need your help. We have learned these things, and we can accomplish this. Get out of our sterile environment. There's Christianity without the power of God. There's Christianity without the functionality of the Holy Spirit. It wants to accomplish those things, and there's things Christianity without the Holy Spirit cannot do, and that is anything concerning miraculous things of God and anything that is pleasing to God. Do you realize that? Without the Spirit, it's impossible to please God. Therefore, if it's impossible to please God without the Spirit, then all those religious things that we do, that we think we're get a rubber stamp and stamp people on the head that, oh yeah, you're saved. I think Jesus has got a lot of talking to do about our immaturity. It's not just a matter of immaturity. It's a matter of our haughtiness of thinking that we can run the universe when it's Him who's supposed to run the universe. We're supposed to get out of the way and do what He says and let Him run the universe. We're peasants at best, and we ignore the King that owns the universe and that can do all things. But if we will take His yoke upon us, that there is a purpose, He is plowing, He is doing something, then we can learn of Him. We can learn to be like Him. We can learn to have His mind. We can learn to have His heart. We can learn to have His purposes. We can become functional with Him. He wants us to get comfortable laying right against Him, and He wants us to see His face as He pulls and how He throws His shoulder into the load that the Father gave Him. And if you think you're going to carry His load, you are foolish. He just allows you to stick your head in the yoke with Him. He allows you to see what it feels like so you can get the thrill. You know, I can remember when I was younger, and my daughter was beside me, and she was always beside me, and she'd never leave my side. And if I was carrying a heavy load, she'd catch a corner of it, and I used to carry ridiculous things, like a refrigerator. Just pick the thing up and put it on my shoulder and carry it to the spot and take it down. We had a spinet piano. I mean, it's a regular piano, upright. I lifted that thing up, pulled it, and carried it in the house myself from the pickup. When I was younger, I did a lot of things. I was very strong, but my daughter would always get hold of that corner. I'm helping, Daddy. I'm helping. Yes, you are, sweetie. Thank you. You might step back. This is a piano. He's a great helper. Jesus lets us so that we can see His eyes and we can have a self-worth that we're working with Him. And He's gentle at it. He doesn't try to throw us into it. He doesn't need our help either. Many people think, well, you're trying to extract something from me. No, He's not. And Satan lies to us and said He's just trying to work it out. No, He's not. Satan is a liar. Jesus just offers His assistance so that you can put His head in His yoke so you can see His eyes. And you can learn what the Father's purposes are. Because if we learn what the Father's purposes are, now there's a reason for the boot camp. There's a reason that we get trained. There's a reason behind all these things that we think are religious and insane and mundane of flying straight and level. And why do I have to do lazy eights? Boy, those are boring. But He says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So if you're honestly put your head in His noose, as some of us call it. His yoke is not heavy. And He has a burden. He carries it. And His burden is very light. You won't even hardly feel it on your shoulders if you accept it. If you are to come, it is because you know He's calling you, right? That was what the mountain was that we saw. He's up there somewhere and He's calling us. He will reveal the heights to which we are to come. I read you a passage of Scripture. to the heights that we are supposed to come. If he's going to do that, then he's the one that's going to have to equip us to come, right? If he's calling, then he provides acquisition. There used to be these video games, and I used to play when I was younger. One of them was Defender, and after you blow up the enemy and all that stuff, then in your spaceship, you could fly down and pick up supplies, and it would refuel you and all that stuff. He's got supplies all along the way. He's got training to prepare us. That's partly one of the functions that I play in your life. And then he will direct us, not supposed to be climbing by yourself. It's dangerous to climb by yourself. I meet many people that climb by themselves and think that they're the anointed one and they're going to show everybody else. We're climbing to him together. We can have fun on our own and learn some things, but true climbing is not by ourselves. You see a problem if this person falls. Doesn't have any safety rope. I can handle it. You learn many things when you're down lower about how to climb rocks and all that stuff, and some people take it too far. And most will take it to their death at some time or another. Occasionally you hear, expert climber falls to his death. Well, of course he will. Doesn't have any flying shoes or anything to save him. Doesn't have anybody to help him. He's not tied to anything, and it's marvelous to try to do those things yourself. But it's insane if we're trying to pursue God and get into the heights of spirituality in something that we don't know about. And I meet some people that have a few experiences down at the lower regions, and they, I know all about it. Don't follow this person. There's places that are higher, a lot higher, where the climate changes. Where the world gets frozen out, and all the particles of dust and filth, God just filters them out and makes them like dust on the ground. So that the air is clean and we can breathe deeper the spiritual essence of Him. As we climb higher and make one ridge and think we're at the top, all of a sudden you look over and you see you're on one of the foothills. Jackie has climbed the 7 highest mountains in the United States. She's also traversed the Grand Canyon. Took her a week to do that. Never did it alone. She did it at a very young age. I think she was about 13 when she started climbing those mountains. Along the way, there are some places that you need to stay. This is a place. It's a little base camp that's been built there. They're called churches. They're going to equip you. And they climb together. Climbing is something that we do together. Why? Because Jesus is supposed to be head of his body, and we're supposed to be his body. Not my own self, my own way, my own purposes. It's supposed to be his body. Climbing can be extremely joyful. But you can't be thinking about working on your car. Can't be thinking about fly fishing or golf. Can't be thinking about just sitting around and vegging. Your mind has to be in the environment that you're in. That's one thing about our pursuit of Jesus. Our mind has to be in the environment. If our mind spiritually is not in an environment, we won't even have a consciousness that Jesus passed by and Jesus is leading. And we won't even buckle up and snap in with somebody else for safety. Some of these things are quite daunting as we grow spiritually. There are some great heights that we need to develop within our stature and with our understanding in order to accomplish what God wants accomplished. So let's talk a little bit about mountains and how about mountains we can move. Faith can be acquired from and through God by the power of the Holy Spirit. Faith can be acquired. Many people don't spend enough time in the yoke to acquire that faith. I think in that yoke is where the faith comes, that we're willing to do whatever he says, whenever he says, and we want to do it. We want to. We desire to do it. Mark 16:14. Here's Jesus. This is after his resurrection. He appeared to the 11 themselves as they were reclining at the table. Jesus shows up. They're sitting there. And he says, I have something against you guys. You didn't believe. You didn't believe me when I said I would be raised from the dead. You didn't believe me when I said I would do these things. He reproached them for their unbelief and their hardness of heart. Two things that he points out there, unbelief and hardness of heart. We're raised kind of in an environment to where we're hard in our heart because we haven't seen God do the miraculous as much as he should be. Our heart gets kind of hardened that he doesn't do those things and we can't call upon him. He just does it at his whim, and it might happen in the hospital, might happen over there. Let's just pray generically. And so our hearts are gospel hardened. See, the gospel, he gave us a command to achieve and do the things miraculously that he did. There's part of the gospel right there. Not only must we believe in him, but we must believe that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And the whole gospel, Paul sums up for us and says, and the ladies saw him at the tomb, and the guys saw him on the road to Damascus, and then the 11 saw him, and then 120 saw him, and then 500 saw him. And he said, this is the gospel I preach to you. As anybody comes to you, even if an angel of light, and tries to preach you any of the gospel, count it as from the pit. And if Jesus is in our midst, and that's the gospel that he is talking about, of Jesus being in our midst, it's so that Jesus can empower us to do the things that he did and train us to do the things that he did. But if our mindset is not agreeable to the gospel, the truth that is there, and it's been turned into the sociological gospel, it's been turned into the watered-down gospel, it's been turned into the sterile gospel, it is just a bunch of words. And the scripture says that the gospel is not words, it's not a bunch of talk. It is the power of God. It is a manifest power of his life and his heart and his mind and his purposes. And a living proof of his manifest presence is a miraculous that's supposed to be taking place in our lives and supposed to be flowing through us to others. So he reproached them because they didn't believe those who hadn't seen him. They didn't even believe. Somebody saw him. I have shared many times, most of the time fruitlessly, especially if I share it with another pastor, about seeing the Lord and all the miraculous things he's done in my life. They don't believe. They blow it off. These are supposed to be my brother hobnobbers, you know? Instead, they start throwing rocks at me. Some of them just plumb indignant. Why would God speak to you and not to me? Problem was within them. I was just sharing the greatest joy of my life, my living Jesus. And I thought they knew him too. They're teaching people. And if you don't know him and he's not alive, what are you teaching? Sterility. That means they're the surgeon. I wish you luck with that. I want Jesus as my surgeon. And he don't have to do nothing. He don't have to get out a knife. He just speaks to it and it's done. He didn't have a lot of long prayers. Most of the time he said, get up. That was his prayer. Be healed. Be made whole. That's short prayers. A lot of power there. I would submit to you the more power, the shorter the prayers. He said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Commission, one we don't like to take on because it takes our time, interrupts our lifestyle, makes us uncomfortable. gives us something to do, embarrasses us. But he makes this statement, he who has believed and who has been baptized shall be saved. But he who has disbelieved shall be condemned. Everybody, we all say we're believers. But now he's going to encapsulate for us what a believer is. These signs will accompany those who believe. In my name, they'll cast out demons. Are you having trouble yet? They'll speak in new languages, languages of angels. This is his definition of a believer. They'll pick up serpents. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. And they will lay their hands on the sick and they will recover. Is our definition of a believer a little bit different than his definition of a believer? I would submit to you that we need to change our definition and stop saying that we're a believer until we do these things. And let's become full believers by taking our yoke, his yoke upon us, and learning of him until we can do these things. Because the gospel that's supposed to be shared is a revelational gospel of Jesus standing there in manifest presence, doing the miraculous. There's many, many examples in Scripture that I could give you. Peter. Let's use Jesus first in Mark. I think it's chapter 5. Jesus is just crossing back from the lake. He had just cast out 10,000 demons out of the guy across the lake. And he gets to this side. And when he gets to this side, there's a synagogue leader, Jairus, that comes running to him. Master, Master, my daughter is... She's sick unto death. Would you come immediately? And Jesus has been healing thousands of people. Great crowds were pressing in against him. They would watch for him. They were all around that lake watching for him. They knew he was there. And how many people in our society, just in this little valley, how many people, if there was really Jesus standing in the midst of it, or God standing in the midst of it, and there was really relief and healing, how many people would be lined up? How many people have a need? At least half the valley. And if they could get in line and if they could get touched, the healing would take place. There were thousands and thousands of people waiting, looking, standing. People without legs being drugged. People without arms. Blind people being led. Lepers people. I'm sure they had a whole pack of lepers people. They had to be separated out, hoping that, okay, they won't let us come in the crowd, but let's stand here in case he passes by here. In the midst of that, Jairus tells him, my daughter, she's nearly dead. Will you please come quick? He doesn't know who he is. He just knows that there's power, that healing is really taking place. And Jairus is kind of excited and, come on, come on, come on. Let's go, let's go. She's dying. And the crowds are pressing against Jesus to prevent them from just taking off and going. And meanwhile, a lady grabs hold of him and power went out from him and he saw power and felt power go out from him. And the lady was healed. There's a whole scene wasting time there. That probably took an hour for those things to take place when the little girl's dying. And finally, some people show up from Jairus' house and says, don't bother the teacher anymore. Your daughter's dead. And Jesus makes the statement, don't worry. Don't be afraid. And he goes on. And of course, we know the story that he raises the little girl from the dead. He tells those Jewish leaders that are in mourning, already having their wake, whole house is in commotion. That's what that means. They have a ritual of commotions where everybody, they hire mourners. You know what hired mourner is? That means you got a very loud screeching voice. And you could, and you could throw dirt good. And a whole bunch of those going on. And he said, you know, what's all this commotion? She's only asleep. The religious guys there laughed at him. You fool! She's dead. You don't know what dead looks like? Go on there looking for yourself. She's dead. He goes in and raises her up. And the whole place goes wild. Why? Because he's presenting the revelational gospel, which is the functionality with the manifest presence of God. And that functionality with the manifest presence of God is where we learn. That's the only place we can learn. Why? Because our faith level comes up where we can receive and believe those things that are beyond our capacity and our own functions, our own understanding. They're beyond. We cannot believe unless we begin to know that He can do those things and see Him do those things and hear Him do those things. That's why He's making the statement that these things you're supposed to do. Peter 2 in Acts 9:32. Peter's traveling through the regions, and a man named Aeneas, he had been bedridden for 8 years. He was paralyzed. Peter said, "Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you." There's another one of those long prayers. He'd learned to pray long prayers from Jesus. "Jesus Christ heals you." Now, our prayer meeting would, "Oh, Lord, we know You're merciful. We know how great You are. If it be Your will, Lord, that this person could use some healing. Oh, God, we beg You, we plead with You." I do that all the time. It takes hearing the voice of Jesus Christ, of Jesus saying, "I'm doing this." And if I can hear that, then I'm not going to bother, "Oh, Lord, will You heal?" I would say, "Be healed in the name of Jesus. Get up." I can't do that unless I've had my head in His yoke. Because He don't talk to anybody that doesn't have their head in His yoke. But yet I get all these yokos that say I'm hearing from God, and they don't have their head in the yoke. How can they? That they're yokos. They don't want the yoke. New paradigm for you there. So Jesus Christ heals you. Get up, make your bed. Immediately He got up. So let's talk equipment. I know we're running a little bit long. Is that okay? I know I swore. No, I didn't swear. I didn't give you an oath that I was going to stop and talk equipment for a minute. Now, we've talked about our training sessions and why we need those. Let's talk about some of the equipment that's available, because we can't accomplish those works unless we can come into 1 Corinthians. Now, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I don't want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles carried away with dumb idols. However, you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. And no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Spirit. I quoted that to you the other day, that He can't become your king unless the Holy Spirit helps you make Him king. That's what Lord means. No one can say He's king. King means we obey Him. We do what He says, and we don't violate, and we're not disobedient to Him. Therefore, or there are diversities of gifts by the same Holy Spirit. There are different kinds of ministries or service, but the same King or Lord. And there are diversities of activities. He's talking about the place where He wants to do something, evidently, right? Diversity of activities, all kinds of activities. But it is the same God who works in all. Whose activities are they? Our Lord God's activities, right? So He has an activity day. I went and visited Tabby's school one time. They have an activity day. Jesus is having activity day today. But the manifestation of the Holy Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. What's supposed to be given to you? The Bible. The Bible is supposed to be given to you for the profit of all. Good works are supposed to be given to you for the profit of all. Helping the poor out there is supposed to be given to you for the profit of all. What's the only thing that will profit all of us? It's a true manifestation, a materialization, a revelation of Jesus and the Holy Spirit in our midst. There's where profit begins. And that's why the corporate church is supposed to work together to get this manifestation of the Holy Spirit in our midst. When the manifestation of the Holy Spirit is there, all of a sudden the Holy Spirit begins, and then right over there, He gives a word of wisdom through the Holy Spirit. Do you even know how important a word of wisdom is? You know how important a word of knowledge is? Because that's the next thing on here. Do you realize those gifts can cause repentance in people's lives? There's been people I've walked up to in times past and didn't know them, never met them. Said, the Lord has shown me that you've been crying out to Him. But He says He has this against you. You're in this adulterous situation. And if you'll come away and here's the name of the girl or guy that you're involved with, and here's what you've been doing, but yet He called you to be His daughter of Zion, and you haven't repented. The person, and by that time, with that knowledge being expressed to them, they have melted in a pool of tears on their legs. Either that, or they've gotten angry and, oh, no. They want to keep their sin, they want to keep the situation, or they repent of the situation. In that repentance, their biggest question is, oh God, I want to come back to You. Words of knowledge and words of wisdom help people come into the gospel, because now that which was within them that would keep the revelation and manifestation of Jesus from coming was broken. So do you realize that in the midst, if we can get the Holy Spirit to come, the greatest power evangelism on earth begins to take place, and that's what was taking place. It was a dangerous thing. You know, there's one passage of Scripture that says, and no one dared join the church anymore. Ananias and Sapphira were struck dead, and great fear come upon people. Why? Because when you came into a church that's active in the gifts of the Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, somebody may come to you and say, you're in this sin and this sin and this sin, and you go out to repent. That's a scary thing. And then you're going to get here a revelatory message from Jesus about your sin, and then you're going to hear what He wants to do about it. And everything gets exposed. No one wants to be in that that doesn't want to be in His presence. But everybody who wants to be in His presence runs to that so that they can be set free. That's why I said no one dared join them. Why? Because they saw the power of God, and God exposes things. They saw the power of God. But God also heals things. God also manifests Himself, and man can't control that. Man can't come in and bend it and make it religious. It's out of their control. And we need things out of the hands of man and in the hands of God to where He can bring His manifest presence, because evangelism takes place in the midst of that. The gospel is preached in the midst of that. And that's something that we're missing. One is given a word of wisdom, another word of knowledge through the same Holy Spirit, another faith by the same Holy Spirit, and another gifts of healing by the same Holy Spirit. This is what we're supposed to be doing. And if this is what we're supposed to be doing, I would submit to you that God has a whole new path. We've been trying to become disciplined. We've been trying to become obedient to our living God. And in the midst of that, our loving Him, He's willing to put His yoke upon us. And He says, here's My yoke. It's evangelism. And I can tell you, you would not believe the blast of expressions that I get from people that don't want to do evangelism. I'm going to have to pass out tracts. Now, that's not evangelism. It being a usable vessel of God is. And how can you be a usable vessel of God unless you have the power of God present within you to be able to express to somebody that the presence of God is real, so that they will open, and then you still don't become their teacher? I'm one of the teachers. What you become is a witness. And the manifest presence of God could heal them. The manifest presence of God might be a word of knowledge. The manifest presence of God might be a deliverance. There might be the need for casting out demonic forces. I've been standing with people and they're chatting away, and I've named the name of the demonic force that they have and command it to come out. And a person just collapses and falls on the ground. Wake up and I can have a conversation with them. You're supposed to be able to cast out demons. Most people in the church can't even identify the ones that are bothering them. That's why I've been trying to teach you to learn the difference between your voice and theirs. Because you can't learn the difference between your voice and theirs when it comes time to try to deal with one somebody else's has. You will not be able to stand in the living presence of God because they will deny that the presence of God can do that. They'll deny that they're there. That's why it's imperative that you learn the difference between your voice and theirs. By another faith, in the midst of this package system that God has, He says, there's where different kinds of ministries are going to take place. It's through you, not through me. My job is to teach you and try to equip you so that you can do these things. Your job is to put on the yoke and say, yes, my Lord, whenever and wherever. He's the one paying attention to that, not me. He doesn't need you for a slave. If you don't become under the yoke, then you'll be a slave, because He says that He will take the heavy burdens off of you. And who puts heavy burdens on us we can't stand? That's the enemy. And he identifies himself as ourself. But the manifestation of the Holy Spirit is given to one, each one for the profit of all. So when we meet, there's supposed to be a word of knowledge, there's supposed to be a word of wisdom, there's supposed to be a prophecy that comes forth. And each one of you are destined to have gifts, and some of you have gifts and you're sitting on them, and you're not active in the Spirit. I would suggest to you that our new season that we're in, if we're going to plant, God said this is going to be a time and I'm going to give seeds, and those seeds can't be planted unless we become active in the Spirit and start using the gifts that we have for one another, laying hands on and praying for one another. Every one of the things that took place, Jesus at the well there at Samaria, He's giving words of knowledge and words of wisdom to a lady that's a harlot, had five husbands, and the guy she shacked up with now is not her own husband. And she says, I perceive you're a prophet. She didn't say, I perceive you're a teacher. She needed a word from God that revealed her sin so that she could understand her sin, so that she could hear the truth. And it took one of the gifts of the Spirit that Jesus modeled for us. The apostles constantly modeled what the gifts of the Spirit look like, and as a result of that, deliverances came, healings came, miracles took place. And who was the agents of that? We just got through reading in Scripture that you're the agent. So I ask you to begin to pray, and Lord, how can I become serious about this? I want to be your agent. Scripture says we're a house, and that there's many articles inside of us, some of silver, some of gold, and it goes into the wood and hay and stubble and all that stuff. Some for noble purposes and some for ignoble purposes. Ignoble means, noble purposes means they're purposes of the king. Ignoble purposes mean they're not purposes of the king. Well, whose purposes are they if they're not purposes of the king? Whose house is it? It's yours. And if it's your house, you can acquire noble purposes. Silver and gold. Inside the house is still going to be our self-serving purposes. And God says, if that person will purge themselves of the latter, then they will become a usable vessel. Usable for what? Usable for this. Usable to go up the mountain. Usable to be in God's presence. Usable to be used in the Spirit so Jesus Christ can manifest Himself in the midst of everything that goes on. We need that practical experience. And I would submit to you, if you will begin to pray and seek God and pray and seek God, we're going to be over the next 40-50 days, something like that, looking seriously at praying. But what we're praying for is to get our head in the yoke. What we're praying for is that God will release His spiritual gifts upon us. What we're praying for is that He would sanctify us so that we can do these things. What we're praying for is He helps us come into our obedience and His commands so that we can come into these things, because we're going to have to get to the point that we can ask Him to do something. He said, ask whatever you will in My name and I will do it for you. Our determined effort has been to expose those things in our life that are not obeying His commands, so that we can learn how to love Him, so that we can back into the part of asking Him whatever He will. Now, I could give you 1,000 different stories and 1,000 different ways of all the miraculous things that consistently take place in my life and in Jackie's life. But I'm telling you, it's hard to put the flesh down. But I'm telling you, it's a delight of my life to stick my head in his yoke and say, yes, my Lord, teach me your ways. Impart to me. All these impartations have to come from a spiritual level and from him. And he's desirous to impart these things to you. Why? Because he said, you're my witnesses. Why? Because he said, I want my power flowing through you, and then the world would be changed. There's no way that you can teach somebody a bunch of words and get them into heaven. You can't talk somebody into heaven. But if there's a manifestation of Jesus, it causes true repentance. And it causes us truly, oh God, you're here. I need you so much. We can't even recognize our need unless we can get in that state. And the Holy Spirit is willing to take us into that. This is our next journey. This is our next stop of becoming a corporate church, climbing together into his presence until we can call down fire from heaven, until we can begin to see healings. I can tell you that House of Prayer started, and it was probably 2.5 to 3 years before we saw first started seeing our miracles take place. 2.5 to 3 years of learning to become disciples. And yes, there was things of words and prophecies and things, but the power of God wasn't released until about 2.5 years later. I can tell you that happened in Grace Chapel there in Tucson. And when they hit that mature mark of wanting to be real disciples and wanting the power of God to be released in their midst, after they become disciples, the power of God was released in their midst. And the church took off. I can tell you in John Wimber's ministry, he was one of those guys that studied how to raise up churches and taught all over the world. He was one of the biggest teachers on demographics and all those different... He worked for Fuller University, and he was full of head knowledge about all these things. And then he got convicted of, this is worthless. He saw that he was trying to talk men into the gospel. And he left Fuller University and decided, the Lord had him start a church, and in there he began to develop and understand, God, we need your miracles. We need healing. And so he opened up a healing room. And it was nearly 2 years before they saw their first healing. 2 years. But once it began, it stayed, and it got greater and greater and greater and greater of God doing great, marvelous things. But they kept after it. The scripture says that's what they were supposed to do, and they kept after it. They put their heads down, and God, we're not going to give up. You are not a liar. I listened to him one time, and he made this statement. He got so mad at God. He said, it's not fair. You tell me to do these things, and you're doing nothing. I'm down here killing myself. Half the church has left because I'm having meetings and we're praying for healing. It's not fair. It was another year before God did anything. He had to come to the revelation of being his personal slave. And my point is, if we want to turn into that, if we want to mature into that, if we want to go into that, we have to see that as the high peak and the high calling of what God is calling us to. And see it as the vision that he sets for us and saying, come to me and do these things. Learn of me. Take on my yoke. And we will turn into that. I expect to see us sometime where we have to move the chairs and we got one person out here and we're praying 3 to 5 to 6 hours for that one person and seeing real deliverances. Seeing real manifestations of God and real change in people's lives and hearts and real healings in our midst. Why? Because it is the power of the gospel. It is the power of the reality of Jesus Christ. And without that, the early church wouldn't have started and maintained itself. Without that, we would not have any of the revivals that swept across. Every revival that has ever taken place, the power of God fell. When it fell, they didn't know what to do with it. They wanted to cover it up. Holy smokes, these people are passed out on their... Don't tell anybody. Don't tell anybody. They've been slain in the Spirit. We don't talk about that. You can look at some of the old religious Methodist revivals. That's in their records. I can tell you what's in your records in heaven. There's written gifts that given to you that you haven't acquired yet. Has written in your book things that you are to accomplish for your great God. There's written in there all the experiences that you've had, but all the manifestations that He sent. There's written in there about you accomplishing the works of God. How many of you working with Him on that book? Let's work harder. He's identified for us what He wants us to become. He's identified for us that we're supposed to do greater things than He did. We're not power mongers. There's no power mongers left here. You know what a power monger is? Just give me your power. Get out of the way. I'll handle it. Name it and claim it. Commanding things to happen. We're not power mongers. But yet, we want the power of God in our presence. And it takes place when we become His disciple. Learn of Him. Do you realize how long the disciples walked with Him before He sent them out to do miracles? They had to learn how to say, yes, sir. Sir, yes, sir. They had to learn those things. And once they learned those things, then He says, now, I want you to go out and cast out demons. Yes, sir. They went out. Well, that guy's got a real bad demon. Look how foul that is. In the name of Jesus, come out. And they would watch it come out. Like, wow, did you see that? Wow, that's cool. It was beyond their comprehension. But it was not beyond their capability because Jesus was the one that empowered. And Jesus is waiting to empower you. This is our new quest, our new purpose, our new calling. Acquire, desire, spiritual gifting. You can't do that. This is saying, okay, I'm going to practice spiritual gift. You do that by getting on your face and calling out to God. Lining your heart, I will do what you say, O Lord. One. Two, I love you, O Lord, passionately love you, O Lord. And three, whatever you want, I will do. Please come and empower me and teach me. When you become pliable, now that means you're going to have to throw some of your wood, hay, and stubble out the door. But He's willing, if you make space, for every article of wood you throw out, He'll give you gold. For every article of stubble you throw out, He'll give you something in place of it that's His. Until your whole house is filled with the things from His kingdom. And you wholly become His vessel here on earth like His Son. Shall we pray? Lord, I thank You for setting new vision in our heart and in our minds. And telling us of the high calling. And showing us climbing the mountains together and linking hand in hand. Making a way that even the weak of us, the weakest of us, could go up whatever slope that there is to believe. Help us receive from You, Lord. Help us absorb from You and be transformed by You. We love You and we thank You for giving us the opportunity to be able to do Your work here on earth, Lord. I praise You and thank You. In Jesus' great, powerful, and precious name I pray. Amen. God richly bless you. And I will see you at 5 o'clock for prayer meeting tonight. Don't forget to love on one another. If anybody needs prayer, I'd be glad to lay hands on you and pray for you. You are dismissed.